All right, welcome everybody to our session, DevOps in Action with OpenShift. My name is Joe Fernandes. I run the product management team for OpenShift. And I'm joined today by three customers, Airbus, Swiss Railways, and Praduban Bank Santander, which is a division of Bank Santander. So planes, trains, and banks. They wouldn't accept that name, but that's another name for the session. Nicholas from Airbus is gonna speak first. He's gonna talk about how they're applying DevOps practices at Airbus and how they're deploying OpenShift to help. Baltazar had to return to Switzerland yesterday due to a family emergency, so we have Christoph Eberle presenting on his behalf. And then Christian from Bank Santander will be up last. So hopefully this is a great session. We're gonna hold questions till the end, so if you have questions, we'll pass the mic around once we're through all three sessions. So thank you again, and with that, I'll introduce Nicholas.
Hello. Hello, so Nicolas Franjo, I work for Airbus. We'll talk 2 seconds about what is Airbus. Maybe some of you know us? Yes? Already try? Bye? Nobody. So, I'm an IT tool startup leader. You will see why we talk about startup. It's very strange, a billion-dollar company with 1,100 of employees with a startup. Very strange, you will see why. Because we talk about DevOps. So in few slides, because you have not bought our product, we have 50,000 employees for manufacturing plane. So it's only manufacturing plane, but we are a group that also build stuff for space. We build spacecraft, we build launcher, military, and also helicopters. Okay, our revenue 40 billion. It's only for the civil aircraft. And this figure is the most important. 9 year backlogs. So we have enough to deliver during 9 years. So one of the issues, it's when you buy a plane today, we'll deliver it to you in 9 years. It's incredible. So what is the solution? To deliver quicker. And if you need to deliver quicker, you need to get better tools in terms of manufacturing and also IT. And we talk about DevOps, which is for delivering quicker. And we talk also about solutions like OpenShift, which allow to deliver quicker. So this is the main stuff, 9 year backlog. I will give you another example. The time to when you want to introduce a new type of plane and when it's available. In 2014, we have announced to the public that we'll have a new plane, the 330 Neo. Okay? 2 years after, this October, the first flight will happen. 2 years between the announce to the public to the first flight. Okay? We start the test on this October and we deliver the first plane 1 year after to a company. So approximately in 3-4 years, you design the plane, you do the test, and you do the first delivery. Okay? Don't be aware, the plane is secure. It's not because we go fast. Don't be aware. Okay. So I work for IT for the company, and I mean, because we are in the US, we are also in the US. Since this year, we have a manufacturing in the US. We manufacture plane in the US, okay? It's in mobile, we have a manufacturing, we deliver few planes from this manufacturing since this year. So it's really important, we are not a European company, sorry, European and also English. We are more and more a world company. We've manufactured in the US, engineering in the US, and also in China. This is really important. So this is where you will find all our IT for Airbus. We are only approximately 1,000, so it's not a lot for the IT stuff. And here, I will talk now about my domain, the infrastructure. So I work in the infrastructure. I support all the infrastructure for all Airbus worldwide. And this is the sizing of our infrastructure. So it's quite big compared to the number of mailbox. We have a mailbox approximately 2.5 gig per user. This is the quota. So when you multiply, it's a terabyte. I would like to highlight just Foupion. It's quite fun, but we have a project to replace all the mobile phone. When we replace mobile phone, we do a rollout for 45,000 mobile phone. So the superior that sells the mobile phone is quite happy. But when we do something to the size of the company, it's big. So when we do open source, it's quite big. It impacts all the company. It's a major decision. And I would like to go to the back office stuff. Why? To the last figure, we do high performance computing. And if you look at the top 500, our computer are inside the top 500 for the supercomputer. We were well placed a few years ago. Unfortunately, the battle is very, very strong, and we lost our place. But we are still in. Just for the history, servers, we have servers, a lot, but we have also servers in plane. If you took the FreeIT, you have approximately half a ton of server in the FreeIT. Half a ton of server in a plane. So it's approximately six, eight passengers. They prefer the company to replace the server to passenger. It's more interesting in terms of economics. So I will move to master. So today, Airbus have decided since approximately 1 year to move to open source. Why we move to open source? We get project. It was an ITSM project. And we decide to use open source to go mainly. Today, you know, there is no licensing. There is nobody from Microsoft, Oracle, and so on in the room. It's okay. We don't have to pay licensing fee. We have only the support to pay. Okay, so this is clear that you can do economy since the beginning. After us, what we target is not that, the main point. Is the top. Why the top? Because today, we think that the cost of the project will be not the technical stuff, will not to buy licensing, will be not, it's human. It's a salary to pay to the human. So more you get people productive, more your cost will reduce on the long term and so on. But for that, we have decided to create a kind of inspiration methodology internal from the open source. We call it the open way of working, okay? And this is linked to DevOps. So we don't go straight to the end to say we'll do DevOps. We say we change our way of working to go to DevOps and to push the technical stuff. Because the problem is what I say all the time to my Red Hat expert. They already sell us technology, but we don't use it. And we'll use it in 5 years, the time that people adopt the technology. So why sell us products that we'll never use, we'll use in 5 years? So what we focus on with the open source is a collaboration, transparency, and sharing empowerment. For us, the most important is really the collaboration. With the collaboration and to break the silos. All of us, we talk about silos, is to break the silos. DevOps is break the silos between the dev and the ops. How you can do it? And this is today our main point, our main work. So we are starting this work in terms of changement, but in parallel, we put in place OpenShift to support it from the technical point. Okay? Next slide. So I will give you two examples of projects that we have deployed from this methodology, and that for us has a major success. Alors, ITOP is one example. It's a tool that we use to support our ITSM, our ITIL process. This tool supports all the assets for the company, and we have deployed it in 3 months. In 3 months, we deploy a tool to support all the assets for the company. Server, back office, front office, connectivity, all the figures you have seen. Only in three months, we have deployed the tool, and we have done all the change. That means training for a user and so on. Why we have successfully done it in 3 months? Because after 1 month, because we use open source, we use an open source project available, we create a partnership with the community, and 1 month after, the first release was available for tests for our users. And we done one release per week. This is not possible if you don't do DevOps. This is not possible. So this is the main reason we have used it. For this one, for example, after we move to OpenShift. Another example, which is just for us is a major success because the entry of services was in June. This is a portal for the end user. When we do a portal for an user, for 100,000 users, okay? It's a portal where the end user will find all his IT support tools. How to manage your incident, how to manage your request. When we talk at incident at Airbus, it's approximately 80,000 incidents per month. After you go to million per year and so on. And this tool is used by the end user to manage their incidents, their requests, their knowledge database access, and so on. We have deployed it. You can see in 2 months, we get a first release available for the end user. Every week for 5,000 approximately end user. OK? Missing 10. For we open it after 3 months. After, we move to 4,000. And in 1 week, we have opened to 4,000 to 100,000. How we've done it? With DevOps. Without, it will be not possible. OK? And again here, we have used Liferay, which is an open source software. We have relied on Liferay. We talk with the Liferay community and so on. So all the time, for all our projects, we really have a strong collaboration with the community. This is a critical point for us. Our DevOps, now I will move really on how we set that in Airbus. It is quite simple. We adapt it to our process. If it's not adapted to the process, nobody will use it. If I talk about OpenShift, if you buy the OpenShift, you put it somewhere in your IT environment, and you say to the user, you can use it, nobody will use it. If it's included in your project methodology, they will use it. So we have changed. We have adapted, changed, work on the project methodology, on the tool, and we have included all of that going to OpenShift in the tool. Why? I will explain the first part. We use ITOP as an internal project referential because we need some few information that you don't find in other software for managing project. And from this tool, they say, I want a project. And when they click, it will create a repository for their project in Tulip, which is an open source software to manage project. I don't know if some of you know this tool, Tulip. It's well used also in US. And they create also their Git repository in the same time and their project in OpenShift. So that means when the project manager starts, with one click, he can create his project repository, the repository for Git, and also for the OpenShift. And it's fully linked to the process. Okay? This is the key for us. Nobody will adopt the solution if they have to raise requests somewhere and so on. The process must be flexible and adapt. After, I would just one word about open source, which is really fun for me. It's two examples. Tulip, for example, we use it in Sierra, in Airbus, and the community of Tulip and the company linked to the project don't know it. It's used by a lot of engineers, and they don't know that we are maybe one of the biggest users of their software. This is incredible, and this is open source, unfortunately. When I walk around the partner, and I ask to some of the project, do you know which are your users, and so on, they say, no, we don't know. We just know that we are downloaded 100 or 1,000 of time. And which is quite interesting also, it's a GFrog Artifactory. I don't know if some of you use it. I've contacted the company GFrog, and I discovered that they have a representative at 1 kilometer from my building. So I contact them at the US, and I say, we can meet, go to my building, and they say, no, you can come, we are at 1 kilometer from your building. This is open source. Sometimes you never know. So for us, the solution, as I say, is OpenShift with the pass. We'll use for two scenarios. The first one is a new project to migrate, to have them on OpenShift. And the second is a migration of application, of PHP application we have. We have all the server and so on, and we need to migrate all this PHP application to something more flexible for the future. and we find that OpenShift is the best solution. So, unfortunately for Red Hat, we are not the major customer for OpenShift. We hope that we'll become. But it's really a use case for the future and obsolescence. At the beginning, when we talked with Red Hat, we are starting with obsolescence. And now we've seen that there is a huge opportunity, and we go for the future. For us, today, OpenShift and the container are the solution. We link it to a new cloud solution, bigger, where we'll have the private, the public, and the OpenShift. So it will be included in our it's included in our cloud strategy for the future. So it's my last slide, it's my conclusion. With open source and DevOps, it is clear that we deliver quicker. I will give you one example. When I talk about the portal for the 100,000 users, we do the entry of services on Monday. On the Friday, I was with the project manager. And the project manager said to me, it's the first time that I will go in weekend and have nothing to do for an entry of services on the Monday. Because usually, when you have an entry of services on the Monday, you spend your weekend to work. And it was the first time that the project manager, which is something that is a 50-year experience, said to me, I will leave and I will have nothing to do. So this is clear that we can improve, we deliver quicker, with the higher satisfaction, with the continuous release, deployment, and so on. We reduce our cost because we have less bug. We don't discover the bug at the last moment. This one is particular. It's for Red Hat, thanks, because we need the right partner for making this project. There is two kinds of partners. There's the partner for the technology, selling the technology and selling some high consulting, like Red Hat. And there is the partner that we work with every day, like Altran, for example. So you have two kinds of partners. You need to find the right partner. The technology is not enough. You can have the technology. If you don't have the right partner, it will not work. And as I say, for us, DevOps, open source, and so on, is really to increase the collaboration. We know that if we target the technology, between the technology, there is also the people. Okay? And it's the people that are, today, you need to change the people. And it's more complex. You can buy, you can invest if you don't change the people. And remove people is more complex than remove server sometimes. Don't forget it. Or do the retirement of application. So, finance cannot be your only criteria to select open source. Can be. For us, now, we do an assessment all the time between open source and proprietary. It was not the case before. It looked like maybe incredible, but when you are a big company, you have contract and you need to follow sometimes the contract. My last sentence is a conclusion. It's open source is the only way on the path, DevOps and so on, to match our constraint for our company, to deliver quicker and so on. I've seen a lot of news on the open source website and so on about collaboration is open source, big data is open source. It's more and more we talk about a topic and we say is open source. And there is no other way to go. So, and it's very interesting, but when Airbus moved to open source, we get with us a lot of companies moving to open source, of suppliers and so on. So it's also very interesting to have big company moving to open source and to get the other ones that follow. If we do it, that means there is a sense, I think. I hope. For our customer. Thanks.
Good. So, next customer. As Joe already announced, I'm not Baltasar Oswald, but Chris Eberle. I don't work for SBB, but I'm a Red Hatter. But our colleague had to fly home yesterday to Switzerland. And I'm working actually with SBB for quite a long time now on OpenShift and other topics, so for more than a year. So I said, no worries, I will step in and I will take the session here. So first of all, who is Swiss Railways? clear, Swiss, they are in Switzerland, and they do rail business, so they run trains for goods as well as persons. And actually, they are plus minus the only rail company, you could say. They have a monopoly there in Switzerland. And we are working with them on OpenShift for quite a while now. And I want to talk is about how they went to OpenShift or why they were thinking about OpenShift at the end. What were the steps which led them there? About Swiss Railways itself, a company has around 30,000 employees, around 2,000 of them in IT. They are as well a software development shop, so they have a few hundred software developers. They do a lot of custom development in-house as well. What I want to start with is actually a talk about DevOps in combination with provider management. So what SBB actually did, or how they started a couple of years ago, is that they introduced, I think it was around 10 years ago or something, where they started to introduce so-called shared platforms, where multiple applications and products projects could put their applications on. Shared platforms for IBM WebSphere, for example, shared platforms for databases, and so on and so on. So they built up these big shared platforms so that all the projects in SBB could put their applications there. There was one problem with these shared platforms, which is the isolation between the applications. So it was a technical limitation which they could not really resolve, network-wise, CPU-wise, that they could not really isolate the stuff from each other. And what they did then, as a consequence, is to introduce processes to mitigate these risks. So you have big change management processes, you have Word templates, which are used for the handover from artifacts from different stages to each other. So they really introduced a big process machinery, you could say, for change management and to mitigate these risks of applications affecting each other. And this, as a consequence, certainly broke up development and operations into different silos, because in the middle you have these big heavyweight processes which just separate the two of them. As well, you had the interface between Dev and Ops was very technology specific. So for every technology, you had own Dev and Ops teams. You had an Ops team for WebSphere, one for database, one for every technology. And what SBB did then is they said, okay, we are going to outsource some of the operations. So the infrastructure operations, for example, is outsourced, the platform operations is outsourced to any provider. And the impact of this is certainly that the gap between Dev and Ops even gets bigger, because it's two different companies, probably two different, or, I mean, we talk Swiss-German in Switzerland, nobody else does, nobody else understands us. If we have to talk English, it's getting a bit tricky. So all these things are coming as well into play if you outsource things to a provider. And what they did then, because the gap was so big, they said, okay, we need to have an ops team as well in SBB itself. So they call it operations management. And what does operations management do? They sit between the provider ops and the development and coordinate activities there. This is what these guys do. So you have another hop or another ops which you're adding to the game here. And this is not enough, certainly, because usually you have multi-provider strategies. So you have multiple provider providing different pieces or operations for different pieces of your infrastructure. And so this is what happened as well. They had to manage different providers for each technology. Still, you have an operations team. So it's not only the different companies you have to manage, the different providers, but as well, per technology, you have such operations teams. And I mean, if they wanted to introduce a change which affected some backend systems and some frontend systems, they had to orchestrate these changes across multiple different operations teams, across multiple different companies even. And this can be very tricky. I mean, usually when you release stuff, you have dependencies, you have to do things in a certain sequence or in parallel, and to coordinate these things across different companies can be really, really tricky. We're still not at the end because then providers start offshore, nearshore, or just shore certain parts of operations. So, for example, network operations was moved somewhere else. And then you even had to talk to even more parts and companies, and you had even more different languages and cultures involved in the operations of a single platform. So what's wrong here? Yes, you have a little bit of dev, and then you have ops. Something is wrong here. So this is what they realized as well. I mean, it kills your innovation in the end. You're very slow in releasing things and so on. And what they actually did, together with us, of course, or with Red Hat, is to introduce OpenShift. And they introduced OpenShift for, on the one hand side, development of applications, and on the other hand, for operations of applications as well. So OpenShift provides, on the one hand side, the isolation of applications from each other, which allowed them to remove these heavyweight processes around and build so-called DevOps teams. The DevOps teams, they are responsible for an application end-to-end, so from the development into over the whole staging into production and maintenance of the application. They are end-to-end responsible for the applications. And what they as well did, so they changed it a little bit, so they introduced a horizontal split of responsibility. SBB itself is responsible for the application and its operations, and the providers are responsible for operating the base platform, so OpenShift. You can still have multi-provider strategies, so you can still have multiple providers providing you an OpenShift platform, which you can use. As well, certainly, OpenShift brings a lot of benefits in automation, often of operational tasks, so operations is getting smaller and smaller. So that's the plan, actually. And one other big thing is that you do not have to have multiple different teams anymore for the different technologies, because the interface between DevOps and OpenShift Ops is not about technology. It's not about, I want to host a JEE server, I want to host a Node.js. This is not important anymore because it's all containerized and it doesn't really, the technology itself doesn't really matter anymore. So the interface is much, much simplified. So what SBB has right now, they run stuff on-premise, they run stuff in public cloud as well on OpenShift, and this brings me to the use cases kind of. So one use case we are currently working on is the SBB mobile app. Actually, it's one of the most popular apps in Switzerland. It's always under the top 5 ranked apps in Switzerland. There is around, I think, 1 million downloads or something. And the backend of this app, this is probably the first use case, is running on AWS. So everything customer-facing will be running on AWS, and other systems like backend systems are running on the internal cluster. This is one of the use cases we are currently implementing. Then the web shop is the next project which is coming. Actually, we have identified around 15 projects which we are going to put to OpenShift by the end of the year. That's the plan. And also, they are currently defining their future technology stack. So they call it their cloud technology stack, consisting of Spring Boot, then Redis database, and so on. So they really define a set of technologies they want to use to build their next generation of applications and are kind of hardening these things on OpenShift now. That was it. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Christian Roldán. I work for ProdOne. So I am the PaaS lead engineer for the Global PaaS service. Let me introduce what is ProdOne. ProdOne is a global company. We belong to the Santander Group. Santander is one of the most important banks in Europe, also in South America. In ProdOne, we are more than 5,000 professionals in 9 countries. We are in Spain, in Germany, United States, in Argentina, Chile, Mexico, Brazil. Okay. So in this slide, I would like to talk about what is the relationship between dev and ops in a traditional IT. In general, in a bank, the relationship is not good. So in our case, we are 2 companies, one for the operation and for the development. So that is a big problem. Devs and ops works in silos in general. When there are big problems in production, in general, the ops says, "Oh, the problem is in the Java code," and the development says, "No, the problem is with the database, the problem is with the proxy, the problem is with the application server, the problem is on the Westfield side." So these are the most common problems in a traditional IT company. Well, in general, the devs sometimes doesn't know or understand the ops environment complexity. In a bank, we have a lot of components. There are a lot of components that are interconnected. So it's really, really complex to understand. The same for the ops. The ops in general, when we receive a new application, for us, the application is a black box. We doesn't know anything about the runtime, how to tune the application, how to configure the application, and that's another problem. Lack of communication between devs and ops, is another big problem. And dev and ops have different objectives. In our case, as I told you, we are 2 different companies, one for production and another for development. So what were the reasons to adopt DevOps in our company? In general, these are the most common reason. What share the same tools for dev and ops. Increase collaboration between devs and ops, reduce deployment time, minimize environment differences, improve time to market, platform tools, automate deployment tasks, provide a global service, reduce infrastructure and operation costs. That is one of the most important topic, one of the most important reason. Continuous delivery also is another important reason why we decide to adopt DevOps approach, improve resolution time, and also more time available to add value, continuous improvement. Okay? So in order to adopt this DevOps approach in ProdOne, we decide to create a service called Global Pass Service for DevOps. This service is based on OpenShift Enterprise version 3, and let's see the current status of this project. We have deployed the Global Pass that is based on OpenShift Enterprise. We have deployed the OpenShift in different regions. We are in Mexico. In Spain, we have 2 data centers, and also in UK. In the next 2 weeks, we will finish the Brazil regions. All the OpenShift are deployed on-premise, are deployed on a Red Hat on OpenStack version Juno. This is our Global Pass architecture. We have a layer of load balancers. We have also 3 availability zones on OpenStack. We have a set of HA proxies for applications, another set of a load balancer for the OpenShift console, another a load balancer for the S3 service. The next layer is the OpenShift master. We have a cluster of masters in different regions. In the same OpenShift master, we deploy the master service and also the etcd service. The next layer is the OpenShift infrastructure nodes. We deploy routers and also the Hakula service. Okay, we are not using the OpenShift registry. Okay, we use an external Docker registry. For the next layer is the OpenShift node. Here is where we run the applications, the containers. We have two kind of nodes, one for production, another for non-production applications. We also deploy a Ceph cluster. The Ceph is used for Docker persistent volumes. We also have a monitoring system for the infrastructure. We use Wild Introscope from CA. For the cloud OpenShift cluster management, we are planning to use CloudForm, but at the moment we don't use CloudForms, but our idea is to use in the near future. For the log management, we have a cluster of Elasticsearch. We send all the infrastructure logs to this central log repository. We use a jump host. From this host, we deploy the global pass infrastructure, and also we manage the OpenShift cluster from this node. We deploy a monitoring solution for the applications. We use a Wild Introscope, and we have an external Docker registry in each region, and we have a data lake for the application logs. All the container standard output and standard error are sent to these data lakes. Our idea is to use this data lake not only for the container logs, also for the metering logs, HTTP access log, etc. Okay, this OpenShift cluster uses external services for DNS, NTP. We use satellite for package management, also for configuration management. All the installation is made by Ansible and Puppet for configuration. In order to improve the DevOps productivity, we found that the OpenShift console is good, but it's not enough. So we decide to create some tools around OpenShift. So the idea is to introduce some tools that we have coded in Product 1. Well, this is the first tool. This is the status page. From this, using this tool, we can get the cluster status. For instance, here we have the master service, we can get the routers, the S3, the Ceph, etc. Also, we can see the status for every production nodes and also from non-production nodes. This is the issues and changes portal. We publish all the issues, or we publish all the changes in this portal. If the change or the issue is really critical, we send an email to all the customers. For instance, here this is the OpenShift upgrade to version 3.2. This is the uptime service. We have different views for the uptime. We, for instance, this is the monthly view. We have the information, the uptime for every month. And also, if you click in this red cycle, you can get the issues and changing for that month. This is a very interesting tool for the DevOps team. For this is another view that is this is daily view. We can get the uptime for every day. For us, measuring and monitoring is really it's really critical. We get metrics for all the OpenShift components. We get in general the uptime, the response time, and we use this uptime. This information, is used to calculate the service level agreement for our customers. We have another service, very interesting service called the notification service. This is a public service. Every Santander employee can subscribe to this service if we want to get information about issues, changes in our platform. You can subscribe. It is public. It's a public service. For instance, we have different channels. For instance, change and issues, newsletters, Docker, corporate images, and also we have a Global Pass portal where we publish tutorials, TechNote, etc. We also provide all this information via the REST. Anyone can get the information through the REST API. So what is the customer opinion about the Global Pass service? In general, the opinion is really excellent. The customer feel very comfortable with the OpenShift version 3.2 is very stable. We have more or less 3,000 containers in production. So in general, the opinion is really, really excellent. So this is the DevOps global team behind the Global Pass service. We are a group of professionals from different countries, from UK, from Brazil, from Spain. And we are also working with two professionals, consultants from Red Hat. That's all. Many thanks.
Great. How about a round of applause for all the speakers? Great job. So we do have some time for questions. So if you want to ask questions of any of our speakers, just raise your hand and I'll pass the microphone around. One in the back.
Hi, Christian. Is it working? Hi, Christian. The question is for you. What is the type of applications that you are currently running in the past, and what kind of workload do you see Produban putting there? Internal, external, mobile?
Can you help?
Yes. Yes. Well, we have two kinds of applications right now in Produban. We have the monolithic application running on
at the moment. We are not thinking of migrating the monolithic application to the new environment, to OpenShift. But we are using Spring Boot. We are using microservices for the new applications. So we are deploying only native application, cloud native application on OpenShift, only that kind of applications. Okay?
Do you want to put a plug-in for
The OpenShift roadmap session starts at 11:30, so if you're interested in seeing where we're going with OpenShift, there'll be live demos. If you have more questions for our speakers, feel free to come up at the end and speak to them in person. And thank you for coming. Hope you enjoy the rest of the roadmap.